Chapter 3, The New School. When she saw the gate of the new school, Tutu-chan stopped. The gate of the new school she used to go had fine concrete pillars with the name of the school in large characters. But the gate of this new school simply consisted of two rather short posts that still had twigs and leaves on them. "This gate's growing," said Tutu-chan. "It will probably go on growing till it's taller than telephone poles." The two gate posts were clearly trees with roots. When she got closer, she had to put her head to one side to read the name of the school because the wind had blown the sign Asuku. Tomoe Gakuen. Tutu-chan was about to ask mother what Tomoe meant when she caught a glimpse of something that made her think she must be dreaming. She squatted down and peered through the shrubbery to get a better look, and she couldn't believe her eyes. "Mother, is that really a train? There in the school grounds." For its classrooms, the school had made use of 6 abandoned railroad cars. To Tutu-chan, it seemed something you might dream about. A school in a train. The windows of the railroad cars sparkled in the morning sunlight. But the eyes of the rosy-cheeked little girl, gazing at them through the shrubbery, sparkled even more. Chapter 4. I like this school! A moment later, Tutu-chan let out a whoop of joy and started running toward the train school, calling out to mother over her shoulder, "Come on, hurry! Let's get on this train that's standing still!" Startled, mother began to run after her. Mother had been on a basketball team once, so she was faster than Tutu-chan and caught hold of her dress as she reached a door. "You can't go in yet," said mother, holding her back. "The cars are classrooms, and you haven't been accepted here yet. If you really want to get on this train, you have to be nice and polite to the headmaster. We're going to call on him now, and if all goes well, you'll be able to go to the school. Do you understand?" Tutu-chan was awfully disappointed not to get on the train right away, but she decided she had better do as mother told her. "All right," she said, and then added, "I like the school a lot." Mother felt like telling her it wasn't a matter of whether she liked the school, but of whether the headmaster liked her. But she just let go of Tutu-chan's dress, took hold of her hand, and started walking toward the headmaster's office. All the railroad cars are quiet, for the first classes of the day had begun. Instead of a wall, the not really spacious school grounds are surrounded by trees, and there were flower beds full of red and yellow flowers. The headmaster's office wasn't in a railroad car, but was on the right-hand side of a one-story building that stood at the top of a semicircular flight about 7 stone steps opposite the gate. Tutu-chan let go of mother's hand and raced up the steps, then turned around abruptly, almost causing mother to run into her. "What's the matter?" mother asked, fearing Tutu-chan might have changed her mind about the school. Standing above her on the top step, Tutu-chan whispered to mother in all seriousness, "The man we're going to see must be a station master." Mother had plenty of patience as well as a great sense of fun. She put her face close to Tutu-chan's and whispered, "Why?" Tutu-chan whispered back, "You said he was the headmaster, but if he owns all of these trains, he must be a station master." Mother had to admit it was unusual for a school to make use of old railroad cars, but there was no time to explain. She simply said, "Why don't you ask him yourself? And anyway, what about Daddy? He plays the violin and owns several violins, but it doesn't make our house a violin shop, does it?" "No, it doesn't," Tutu-chan agreed, catching hold of Mother's hand. Chapter 5. the headmaster. When Mother and Toto-chan went in, the man in the office got up from his chair. His hair was thin on top and he had a few teeth missing, but his face was a healthy color. Although he wasn't very tall, he had solid shoulders and arms and was neatly dressed in a rather shabby black three-piece suit. With a hasty bow, Toto-chan asked him spiritedly, "What are you, a schoolmaster or a station master?" Mother was embarrassed, but before she had time to explain, he laughed and replied, "I'm the headmaster of this school." Toto-chan was delighted. "Oh, I'm so glad," she said, "because I wanted to ask you a favor. I'd like to come to your school." The headmaster offered her a chair and turned to Mother. "You may go home now. I want to talk to Toto-chan." Toto-chan got a moment's uneasiness, but somehow felt she would get along right with the man. "Well then, I'll leave her with you," Mother said bravely, and shut the door behind her as she went out. The headmaster drew over a chair and put it facing Toto-chan. And when they are both sitting down close together, he said, "Now then, tell me all about yourself. Tell me anything at all you wanted to talk about." "Anything I like?" Toto-chan expected him to ask questions she would have to answer. When he said she could talk about anything she wanted, she was so happy she began straight away. It was all a bit higgledy-piggledy, but she talked for all she was worth. She told the headmaster how fast the train went, that they had come on, how she had asked the ticket collector, but he wouldn't let her keep the ticket, how pretty her homeroom teacher was at the other school, about the swallow's nest, about their brown dog Rocky, who can do all sorts of tricks, how she used to go snip-snip with the scissors in her mouth at kindergarten, and the teacher said she mustn't do that because she might cut her tongue off. But she did it anyway, how she always blew her nose because Mother scolded her if it was runny, what a good swimmer Daddy was, and how he could dive as well. She went on and on. The headmaster would laugh, nod, and say, "And then?" And Toto-chan was so happy she kept right on talking. But finally she ran out of things to say. She sat with her mouth closed, trying hard to think of something.
"Haven't you anything more you can tell me?" asked the headmaster.
What a shame to stop now, Toto-chan thought. It was such a wonderful chance. Wasn't there anything else she could talk about, she wondered. Racking her brains? Then she had an idea. She could tell him the dress she was wearing that day. Mother made most of her dresses, but this one came from a shop. Her clothes are always torn when she came home in the late afternoon. Some of the rips were quite bad. Mother never knew how they got that way. Even her white cotton panties were sometimes in shreds. She explained to the headmaster that they got torn when she crossed the other people's gardens by crawling under their fences, and when she burrowed under the barbed wire around vacant lots. So this morning, she said, when she was getting dressed to come here, all the nice dresses Mother had made were torn, so she had to wear one Mother had brought. It had small dark red and gray checks, and was made of jersey, and it wasn't bad, but Mother thought that the red flowers embroidered in the collar were in bad taste.
"Mother doesn't like the collar," said Toto-chan, holding it up for the headmaster to see. After that, she could think of nothing more to say, no matter how hard she tried. It made her rather sad. But just then, the headmaster got up, placed his large, warm hand on her head, and said,
"Well, now you're a pupil of this school."
Those were his very words, and at that moment, Toto-chan felt that she had met someone she really liked for the first time in her life. You see, up till then, no one has ever listened to her for so long. And all that time, the headmaster hadn't yawned once or looked bored, but seemed just as interested in what she had to say as she was. Toto-chan hadn't learned how to tell time yet, but it did seem a rather long time. If she had been able to, she would have been astonished and more grateful to the headmaster. For you see, Mother and Toto-chan arrived at the school at 8, and when she had finished talking and the headmaster told her she was a pupil of this school, he looked at his pocket watch and said, "Ah, it's time for lunch."
so the headmaster must have listened to Toto-chan for 4 solid hours. Neither before nor since did any grown-up listen to Toto-chan as long as that. And besides, it would have amazed mother and her homeroom teacher to think that a 7-year-old child could find enough to talk about 4 hours non-stop. Toto-chan had no idea then, of course, that she had been expelled and that people were at their wits' end to know what to do. Having a naturally sunny disposition and being a bit absent-minded gave her an air of innocence. But deep down, she felt was considered different from other children and slightly strange. The headmaster, however, made her feel safe and warm and happy. She wanted to stay with him forever. That's how Toto-chan felt about headmaster Sosaku Kobayashi that first day. And luckily, the headmaster felt the same about her. Chapter 6, Lunchtime. The headmaster took Toto-chan to see where the children had lunch.
"We don't have lunch in the train," he explained, "but in the assembly hall."
The assembly hall was at the top of the stone steps Toto-chan had come up earlier. When they got there, they found the children noisily moving desks and chairs about, arranging them in a circle. As they stood up in one corner and watched, Toto-chan tugged to the headmaster's jacket and asked, "Where are the rest of the children?"
"This is all there are," he replied.
"All there are?" Toto-chan couldn't believe it. There were as many children as this just in one grade in the other school.
"You mean there are only about 50 children in the whole school?"
"That's all," said the headmaster.
Everything about this school was different from the other one, thought Toto-chan. When everyone was seated, the headmaster asked the pupils if they had brought something from the ocean and something from the hills.
"Yes," they chorused, opening their various lunch boxes.
"Let's see what you've got," said the headmaster, strolling about in the circle of desks and looking into each box while the children squealed with delight.
"How funny," thought Toto-chan. "I wonder what he means, something from the ocean and something from the hills." This school was different. It was fun. She never thought lunch at school could be as much fun as this. The thought that tomorrow she would be sitting at one of these desks, showing the headmaster with her lunch, with something from the ocean and something from the hills, made Toto-chan so happy she wanted to jump for joy. As he expanded the lunch boxes, the headmaster's shoulders were bathed in soft noontime light. Chapter 7, Toto-chan Starts School. After the headmaster had said,
"Now you're a pupil of this school,"
Toto-chan could hardly wait for the next day to dawn. She had never looked forward to a day so much. Mother usually had trouble getting Toto-chan out of bed in the morning, but that day she was up before anyone else, all dressed and waiting with her school bag snapped to her back. The most punctual member of the household, Rocky, the German Shepherd, viewed Toto-chan's unusual behavior with suspicion, but after a good stretch, he positioned himself close to her, expecting something to happen. She busily made up a lunchbox containing something from the ocean and something from the hills while she gave Toto-chan her breakfast. Mother also put Toto-chan's train pass in a plastic case and hung it around Toto-chan's neck.
"Be a good girl,"
said Daddy, his hair all tousled.
"Of course."
Toto-chan put on her shoes and opened the front door, then turned around, bowed politely and said, "Goodbye, everybody." Tears welled up in Mother's eyes as she watched Toto-chan go out. It was hard to believe that this vivacious little girl, setting off so obdurately and happily, had just been expelled from school. She prayed fervently that all would go well this time. A moment later, Mother was startled to see Toto-chan remove the train pass and hang it around Rocky's neck instead. "Oh dear," thought Mother, but she decided to say nothing but wait and see what happened. After Toto-chan put the cord with the pass around Rocky's neck, she squatted down and said to him, "You see, the pass doesn't fit you at all." The cord was much too long and the pass dragged on the ground. "Do you understand? This is my pass, not yours. You won't be able to get on the train. I'll ask the headmaster, though, and see if they'll let you come to school, too."
Rocky listened attentively at first, ears pointed, but after giving a pass a few licks, he yawned. Toto-chan went on, "The classroom train doesn't move, so I don't think you'll need a ticket to get on that one, but today you'll just have to stay home and wait for me." Rocky always used to walk with Toto-chan as far as the gate of the other school, then had come back home. Naturally, he was expecting to do the same today. Toto-chan took the cord, moved the pass off Rocky's neck, and carefully hung it around her own. She called out once more to Mother and Daddy, "Goodbye!" Then she ran off, without a backward glance, her bag flapping against her back. Rocky bounded along happily beside her. The way to the station was almost the same as the old school, so Toto-chan passed dogs and cats she knew, as well as children from her former class. Should she show her pass and impress them? Toto-chan wondered. But she didn't want to be late, so she decided not to that day, and hurried on. When Toto-chan turned right at the station instead of left as usual, poor Rocky stopped and looked around anxiously. Toto-chan was already at the ticket gate, but she went back to Rocky, who stood looking mystified. "I'm not going to the other school anymore. I'm going to a new one." Toto-chan put her face against Rocky's. His ears were smelly, as usual, but to Toto-chan, it was a nice smell. "Bye-bye," she said, and showing the man her pass, and she started climbing up the steep station stairs. Rocky whimpered softly and watched until Toto-chan was out of sight. Chapter 8. The Classroom in the Train. No one had arrived yet when Toto-chan got to the door of the railroad car the headmaster had told her would be her classroom. It was an old-fashioned car, one that still had a door handle on the outside. You took hold of the handle with both hands and slid the door right to the right. Toto-chan's heart was beating fast with excitement as she peeped inside. Ooh! Studying here would be like going on a perpetual journey. The windows still had baggage racks above them. The only difference was that there was a blackboard at the front of the car, and the lengthwise seats had been replaced by school desks and chairs all facing forward. The hand straps had gone too. But everything else had been left just as it was. Toto-chan went in and sat down at someone's desk. The wooden chairs resembled those at the other school, but they were so much more comfortable that she could sit on them all day. Toto-chan was so happy and liked the school so much, she made a firm decision to come to school every day and never take any holidays. Toto-chan looked out of the window. She knew the train was stationary, but was it because the flowers and the trees in the school grounds were swaying slightly in the breeze? It seemed to be moving. "I'm so happy!" she finally said out loud, and she pressed her face against the window and she made up a song just as she always did when she was happy. "I'm so happy am I. Why am I happy? Because..." Just at that moment, someone got on. It was a girl. She took her notebook and her pencil box out of her school bag and put them on her desk. And she stood on tiptoe and put the bag on the rack. She put her shoe back up there too. Toto-chan stopped singing and quickly did the same. After that, a boy got on. He stood at the door and threw his bag on the rotten baggage rack as if he was playing basketball. It bounced off and fell on the floor. "Bad shot!" said the boy, taking aim again from the same place. This time it stayed on. "Nice shot!" he shouted, following by. "No, bad shot!" as he scrambled onto the desk and opened his bag to get out the notebook and the pencil box. His failure to do this first evidently made it count as a miss. Eventually, there were 9 pupils in the car. They comprised the first grade at Tomoe Gakuen. They would all be traveling together on the same train. Chapter 9. Lessons at Tomoe. Going to school on a railroad car seemed unusual enough, but the seating arrangements turned out to be unusual too. At the other school, each pupil was assigned a specific desk, but here, they're allowed to sit anywhere they liked at any time. After a lot of thought and a good look around, Toto-chan decided to sit next to the girl who had come after her this morning because this girl was wearing a pinafore with a long-eared rabbit on it. The most unusual thing of all about the school, however, was the lessons themselves.
School normally schedule one subject, for example, Japanese, the first period. When you just do Japanese then, arithmetic the second period, just when you do arithmetic. But here it was quite different. At the beginning of the first period, the teacher made a list of all the problems and questions in the subjects need to be studied that day. Then she would say, "Now, start with any of these you like." So whether you started on Japanese, or arithmetic, or something else, didn't matter at all. Some who liked composition might be writing something, while behind you, someone who liked physics might be boiling something in a flask over an alcohol burner, so that a small explosion was liable to occur in any of the classrooms. This method of teaching enabled the teachers to observe, as the children progressed to higher grades, what they were interested in as well their way of thinking and their character. It was an ideal way for teachers to really get to know their pupils. As for the pupils, they loved being able to start with their favorite subject, and the fact that they had all day to cope with the subjects they disliked meant they could usually manage them somehow. So study was mostly independent, with pupils free to go and consult the teacher whenever necessary. The teacher would come to them too if they wanted, and explain any problem till it was thoroughly understood. Then pupils would be given further exercises to work out alone. It was study in the truest sense of the word, and it meant there were no pupils just sitting inattentively while the teachers talked and explained. The first grade pupils haven't quite reached the stage of independent study, but they were allowed to start with any subject they wanted. Some drew pictures, some read books, and some even did calisthenics. The girl sat next to Dodo Chan already knew her alphabet and was writing it into her notebook. It was all so unfamiliar that Toto-chan was a bit nervous and unsure what to do. Just then, the boy sitting behind her got up and walked toward the blackboard with his notebook, apparently to consult with the teacher. She sat at the desk beside the blackboard and was explaining something to another pupil. Toto-chan stopped, looking around the room, and, with her chin cupped in her hands, fixed her eyes on his back as he walked. The boy dragged his leg and his whole body swayed dreadfully. Toto-chan wondered at first that he was doing on purpose, but she soon realized that the boy couldn't help it. Toto-chan went on watching him as the boy came back to his desk. Their eyes met. The boy smiled. Toto-chan hurriedly smiled back. When he sat down at the desk behind her, it took him longer than the other children to sit down. She turned around and asked, "Why do you walk like that?" He replied quietly in a gentle voice that sounded intelligent, "I have polio." "Polio?" Toto-chan repeated, never having heard of the word before. "Yes, polio," he whispered. "It's not only my leg, but my hand too." He held it out. Toto-chan looked at his left hand. His long fingers were bent and looked as if they're stuck together. "Can't they do anything about it?" she asked, concerned. He didn't reply. And Toto-chan became embarrassed, wishing he hadn't asked. But the boy said brightly, "My name is Yasuke Yamamoto. What's yours?" She was so glad to hear him speak in such a cheerful voice that she replied loudly, "I'm Toto-chan." And that's how Yasuke Yamamoto and Toto-chan became friends. The sun made it quite hot inside the train. Someone opened a window. The fresh spring breeze blew through the car and tossed the children's hair about with carefree abandon. In this way, Toto-chan's first day at Tomoe began. Chapter 10: Seafood and Land Food. Now it was time for something from the ocean and something from the hills, the lunch hour Toto-chan had looked forward to so eagerly. The headmaster had adopted the phrase to describe a balanced meal, the kind of food he expected you to bring for lunch in addition to your rice. Instead of the usual, train your children to eat everything, and please see that they bring a nutritiously balanced lunch, the headmaster asked parents to include their children's lunch boxes, something from the ocean and something from the hills. Something from the ocean meant seafood, things such as fish and tsukudani, tiny crustaceans, and the like boiled soy sauce and sweet sake. While something from the hills meant food from the land, like vegetables, beef, pork, and chicken. Mother was very impressed by this and thought that few headmasters were capable of expressing such an important rule so simply.
Oddly enough, just having to choose from two categories made preparing lunch seem simpler. And besides, the headmaster pointed out that one did not have to think too hard or be extravagant to fulfill the two requirements. The land food could be just kinpiro gobo, spicy burdock, or an omelet, and the seafood merely flakes or dried bonito. Or simpler still, you could have nori, a kind of seaweed. You could have nori, a kind of seaweed, for ocean, and a pickled plum for hills. Just as the day before, when Tudachan had watched so enviously, the headmaster came and looked in all the lunchboxes. Do you have something from the ocean and something from the hills? He asked, checking each one. It was so exciting to discover what each had brought from the ocean and from the hills. Sometimes a mother had been too busy, and her child had only something from the hills or only something from the ocean. But never mind. As the headmaster made his round of inspection, his wife followed him, wearing a cook's white apron and holding a pan in each hand. If a headmaster stopped in front of a pupil saying, "Ocean," she would dole out a couple of boiled chikuwa, fish rolls, from the ocean saucepan. And if the headmaster said, "Hills," out come some chunks of soy simmer potato from the hills saucepan. No one would have dreamed of saying, "I don't like fish rolls," any more than thinking what a fine lunch so-and-so has, or what a miserable lunch poor so-and-so always brings. The children's only concern was whether they had satisfied the two requirements, the ocean and the hills, and if so, their joy was complete and they're all in good spirits. Beginning to understand what something from the ocean and something from the hills was all about, Tudachan had doubts whether the lunch her mother had so hastily prepared, but when she opened the lunchbox, she found such a marvelous lunch inside, it was all she could do to stop herself shouting, "Oh, goody, goody!" Tudachan's lunch was contained bright yellow scrambled eggs, green peas, brown denbu, and pink naked otoro. It was as colorful as a newer garden. "How very pretty," said the headmaster. Tudachan was thrilled. "Mother's a very good cook," she said. "She is she?" said the headmaster. Then he pointed to the denbu. "All right, what's this? Is it from the ocean or the hills?" Tudachan looked at it, wondering which was right. It was the color of earth, so maybe it was from the hills. But she couldn't be sure. "I don't know," she said. The headmaster then addressed the whole school. "Where does denbu come from?" Then addressed the whole school. "Where does denbu come from, the ocean or the hills?" After a pause, while they thought about it, some shouted, "Hills!" The others shouted, "Ocean!" But no one seemed to know for certain. "All right, I'll tell you," said the headmaster. "Denbu is from the ocean." "Why?" asked a fat boy. Standing at the middle of the crown of the circular desks, the headmaster explained, "Denbu is from scraping the fresh flesh of cooked fish off the bones, lightly roasting and crushing it into fine pieces, which are dried and flavored." "Oh," said the children, impressed. Then someone asked if they could see Tudachan's denbu. "Certainly," said the headmaster, and the whole school trooped over to look at Tudachan's denbu. They must have been children who knew what denbu was, but whose interest had been aroused, as well as those who wanted to see Tudachan's denbu was any different from the kind it had at home. So many children sniffed at Tudachan's denbu that she was afraid that bits might get blown away. Tudachan was a little nervous the first day of lunch, but it was fun. It was fascinating wondering what was seafood and what was land food. She learned that denbu was made of fish, and mother had remembered to include something from the ocean, and something from the ocean, and something from the hills. So, all in all, everything had been all right, she thought contentedly. And the next thing that made Tudachan happy was that when she started to eat the lunch mother had made, it was delicious. Chapter 11. Chew It Well. Normally one starts a meal by saying, "Itadokimasu!" I gratefully partake, but another thing that was different from Tomoegakuen was that first of all everybody sang a song. The headmaster was a musician, and he had made up a special song to sing before lunch.
Actually, he just made up the words and said them to the tune of the well-known round, Row, row, row your boat. Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, 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 merry, life is but a dream.
The words the headmaster made up went like this.
Chew, chew, chew it well, everything you eat. Chew it and chew it and chew it and chew it, your eyes are fish and meat.
It wasn't until they finished singing the song that the children all said, Itadakimasu! The words fitted the tune of Row, Row, Row Your Boat so well that even years later, many of the pupils firmly believed that it was always been a song you sang before eating. The headmaster may have made up the song because he has lost some of his teeth, but he was telling the children to eat slowly and take plenty of time over meals, so it is more likely he made up this song to remind them of that. After they had sang the song at the tops of their voices, the children all said, Itadakimasu! And settled down to something from the ocean and something from the hills. For a while, the assembly hall was quiet.
Kira, kira. Dingle twin.